Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup by People's Dispatch, where we bring you major news developments from around the world. Our headlines: Iran condemns fresh US sanctions on banking sector. Protests rage in Indonesia against sweeping omnibus law. Hundreds are arrested by the police. World commemorates the 53rd Martyrdom Day of Che Guevara. An Algerian court sentences Iraq protester Yasin Mubarki to 10 years in prison. In our first story on Thursday, the US Treasury Department announced fresh financial sanctions on Iran's banking sector. Reacting strongly to the move, Iran's Foreign Minister Javad Zarif called the announcement of these sanctions amid the COVID-19 pandemic the US regime's attempt to blow up remaining channels to pay for food and medicine. He claimed that the conspiracy by the US, in his words, to starve a population is a crime against humanity. The US Treasury Department announced that it is blacklisting 18 major Iranian banks, calling the entire financial sector of the country an additional avenue that funds the government's so-called malign activities. The US has alleged that Iran is developing nuclear weapons and supporting terrorist groups in the region. Both these allegations have been denied by the Iranian government. Iran claims that the aggression against the country is an attempt to thwart its independence and its regional and foreign policy. The US sees rising Iranian influence in West Asia as a threat to its domination. Fearing that their banks will be impacted, the Trump administration's latest move has been criticized by European countries. Meanwhile, activists have said that these sanctions will hamper humanitarian supplies to Iran, which are necessary to deal with the COVID-19 outbreak. Some activists have even called it a crime against Iranian people. The US has refused to listen to official UN appeals to desist from imposing sanctions during the pandemic. It has announced new sanctions on Iran during the past few months. The Trump administration has also tried to bring back international sanctions on Iran, which were withdrawn by the United Nations after a nuclear deal was signed in 2015. After 13 out of the 15 members of the UN Security Council refused to consider the US demand for these sanctions, it went ahead and unilaterally announced the imposition of sanctions. In our next story, thousands of Indonesians have taken to the streets of Jakarta, Bandung and other cities in protest against the government's push to enact the omnibus law. As of Thursday, over 400 protesters were arrested in police crackdowns across the country. This exhaustive job creation law, which is passed by the lower house of the parliament, which is the People's Representative Council, has prompted a countrywide backlash from trade unions and student movements. A coalition of trade unions, student groups and environmental activists are holding countrywide protests to oppose this law that the Joko Widodo government claims will create millions of jobs. The law, which is called the Omnibus Law, brings together changes over 79 existing laws concerning labor, environment, private investment and many more. It alters labor laws, taking out major protections for minimum wages, paid leave and severance pay. Workers can expect to see their severance pay to be cut by 40% weekly, weekly holidays to be reduced to one day, and even their paid annual leaves at risk. Most importantly, workers will lose federal protection to their minimum wages. The law completely does away with sectoral minimum wages in favor of localized minimum wage standards set by governors. The law also takes out significant environmental regulations and limits on polluting industries and brings down the number of sectors barred from private investments from 300 to a mere 6. Trade unions have been opposing the law after it was proposed in February this year. Multiple demonstrations by unions prompted the government bloc in the DPR to push the debate and vote several times. Various trade union movements have called for public deliberations over the law, but the Widodo government ignored these calls and pushed it with very little debate on Monday. In our next story, marking the 53rd Martyrdom Day of revolutionary Ernesto Che Guevara, 20 left publishers are all set to bring out an e-book titled Che in almost 20 languages. The text in Che are The Letter to Tricontinental and Man and Socialism in Cuba, two iconic works by Che Guevara that explain his internationalist perspective and the process of socialist construction within Cuba. The texts come with a preface by Maria del Carmen Arriet Garcia and an introduction by eminent Marxist intellectual Ejaz Ahmed. The book was released on Friday, marking the anniversary of Che's assassination by the CIA-led contingent of the Bolivian army. October 9th is now being observed as the International Day for the Abolition of CIA. The book release is also part of the observance of the International Week of Anti-Imperialist Struggle from October 5 to 10. To discuss this further, Vijay Prashad talked to Ejaz Ahmed.
As I said, today is the anniversary of the murder, assassination, death of Che Guevara. Che is generally understood in a sort of legendary way, you know, outside the real Che. he is lifted up to legend. In your introduction, you actually bring us back to earth and give us some of the central themes of Che Guevara's life, very brief life, but a life filled with action and accomplishment. Could you walk us through a little bit about the contexts of Che's life and the things that he did in that life?
Che, he has been raised to the level of a legend. Rightly so. But I think what happens with the raising of him to the level of a legend is that the figure is romanticized out of his actual existence. romanticized both as this brilliant guerrilla fighter and as martyr to the revolutionary cause, fearless, and so on, which is, I think, somewhat reductive. Che, I think, from the very beginning of his, from the time of his youth, had, first of all, an immense curiosity about the world that he lived in. For example, while he was still a medical student, he went on a tour of all of Latin America to actually know his continent. Secondly, he was, I think, from the very beginning, a very voracious reader. On the one hand, a trained medical doctor, and at the same time, a great voracious reader of revolutionary literature and revolutionary history. And it's significantly, and you know, the amazing thing about Che is that his entire life, actual texture of his life, is that of profound internationalism. So that he happens to be in Guatemala at the time when there is an American intervention, an American sponsored coup d'etat against the government of Arbenz. And as a young man there, that is the first time he immediately commits himself to fight with arms in the defense of that revolution. So something that he said much later, or variations of which he kept saying all his life, is that when you are talking about the revolution and revolutionaries, it is not enough to support. You have to join the struggle and either win or lose, die, or you go to death or victory as a part, as an element, a proletarian element in this great revolutionary wave of our time. And he always saw himself as that. At the same time, for him, the ultimate arena of revolution was actually the world. And it's dialectically thought out that imperialism, you no longer have national, you know, capitalism in this country, in that country, in that country. The very fact that that capitalism has entered what, as he put it, the last stages of capitalism is imperialism.
And finally, on Thursday, Algeria stepped up its persecution of anti-government Hirak protesters and independent journalists. A court in Algiers sentenced well-known Hirak movement member Yassin Mubaraki to 10 years in prison, along with a steep fine of $77,000. Mubaraki was sentenced after being accused of various charges such as inciting atheism, offending or denigrating dogma and precepts of Islam, and undermining national unity. Along with Mubaraki, journalist activist Fadil Bomala also faces the prospect of being sentenced to 2 years in prison and a fine of $700 after a prosecutor's office in Algiers appealed for the same. Another journalist, El Qadi Ihsan, was also summoned by the authorities for preliminary investigations this week. Ihsan has been accused by the Algerian authorities of defamation, insults, and offences against the President of Algeria. These kind of charges point to a clear attempt by the Algerian government to intimidate and silence critics and opposition figures, especially members of the Hirak protests. The movement had demanded the removal of all corrupt and inefficient politicians and businessmen belonging to the era of former President Abdulaziz Bouteflika, who was deposed. Bouteflika was forced out of power in April 2019 after ruling for more than 20 years. The massive Hirak protests continued as they wanted those associated with his regime to also leave power. That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from around the world. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch. Yeah, cantante, vamos a triunfar, avanza ya.